Yeah, I mean, we'll have to see if we can discover the fabled Game 3 in Top Cut. I didn't find it in Top 8, but I don't think either of these trainers are going to go down easy.
Well, like we mentioned, Michael is the Sacramento Regional Champion from earlier in this season, would be the first repeat regional champion for the 2024 season if he is able to win Vancouver. Of course, does need to make his way through James first and make his way into the finals. Has that Tyranitar pin, which we have seen previously, guarantees all rock slides from this Tyranitar. But here is the team, if you missed it earlier. It is sort of a new look at the Kumuo and Tyranitar team that he won Sacramento with, instead adding a new Psyspam version with the Iron Crown and Indeedee alongside that, and the Whimsicott for some additional support options.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun to see how this plays out. I think last time we saw him on stream, it was sort of difficult for him to pick some of his Pokemon, where I think this time we might see a little different look. So always fun when we get repeat customers, can see even more of what their teams can do.
Absolutely. We'll have to see if Michael's going to be able to shake things up going up against James Evans's team. I'm really excited to see more out of this Tyranitar and Kumuo. The last time we saw both of them on stream, unfortunately, the Tyranitar just got critical hit, and then Kumuo was not able to do much of anything without the additional support. But Michael still was able to win that match by using his Iron Crown and Indeedee mode, so has plenty of options moving forward. But he has to get through James Evans here, last seen in the finals of the Knoxville Regional Championships, and previously is a Seniors Division World Champion, a Masters Division North American International Champion, and a 2018 Seniors Division European International Champion. So this is a player who is, we talk a little bit about some of the nerve-wracking turns for $2,000. James has been on the biggest stages in the world for Pokemon and has come out on top.
Yeah, a lot of good words under his name there, where
champion.
Especially for a player as young as him, right? Where it seems like just yesterday he was competing in the senior division, and now he's been one of the best players in the Masters Division for quite a long time.
Well, here is the Gouging Fire team that he has been using. Some small adjustments made since Knoxville, especially I can see there the Choice Specs Fluttermane versus Focus Sash that he was using previously, but still a team centered around the Howl Breaking Swipe Gouging Fire.
Yeah, I think it kind of creates a fun theme for three of our four semifinalists, where they're kind of using team cores that are kind of very unique to them. You know, we've seen the King Gambit Gouging Fire thing from James, Michael running back the Kumuo and Tyranitar that he won a regional with, and you know, Scott with the Porygon team. So kind of fun. Everyone's got their own take on it, and I really do think there's something to be said for being the best player of your archetype. You know, hard to win a tournament if you're not.
Absolutely. And I think a really interesting thing to point out about the James's team is, of course, the Rillaboom into any kind of psychic terrain-based team is going to be extremely important, both to be able to reset the terrain, but also has Taunt and is not the Assault Vest. It's actually the Meadow Plate Rillaboom. So going for a more offensive Rillaboom will need to rely on the terrain to reduce the damage from the Expanding Force instead of the Assault Vest.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun to watch. I'm sure James has played plenty of games against Psyspam with this team, so we should get to see a fun back and forth, assuming Michael opts to go for that mode. And with Iron Crown here, probably a good hint that Indeedee's hiding somewhere.
Yeah, Indeedee's probably hiding somewhere, but not out front, which means that Iron Crown is staring down this Wellspring Mask Form Ogre Pond alongside the Gouging Fire. Booster energy is going off for both the Iron Crown and the Gouging Fire, as expected. It is going to be the Hearthflame Ogre Pond alongside the Iron Crown. So really interesting lead sets here. The Gouging Fire and Wellspring Ogre Pond is a fairly standard lead here, but I was not expecting to see Iron Crown next to the Ogre Pond.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps giving some options, we could pivot either direction, but because of that, also likely going to be a little slower start than maybe if he'd led two Pokemon that synergize more clearly, and that could be tough against James's team. You know, he can pivot pretty well, but also he does have options for increasing his own damage, so you know, letting him ramp relatively uncontested would be pretty dangerous.
Yeah, absolutely cannot let these players get any kind of uncontested advantage. Here we are in turn one of game one. James is going to protect his Wellspring Mask Form Ogre Pond, going to go ahead and Terastalize to become a pure water type, and importantly, get the Embody Aspect boost to boost the special defense. Something that can be very useful to help protect against expanding forces coming out from Iron Crown. No terrestrializations, no switches, just a calm mind. Michael is choosing to use the follow me on his Hearthflame Ogre Pawn to protect the Iron Crown, tank any kind of potential damage from the Ogre Pawn or the gouging fire, and just going for the calm mind. Really important to note here that the fastest Pokemon on the field now is that Iron Crown, though.
Yeah, Ivy Country coming down there, going to absolutely annihilate the opposing Ogre Pond, and James going to pick up the first knockout in what was otherwise a pretty slow turn.
Yeah, I was not expecting a one-hit KO there, and especially not without a critical hit, but the Terrestrialization from that Ogre Pond with the Howl Boost from Gouging Fire able to pick up that KO, this Calm Mind had better be worth it.
Yeah, I mean, a very boosting themed match so far. Como pretty excited. Okay, oh, I heard we were boosted. I can boost.
I boost.
And Jim's maybe all done boosting, though, and I'm in a position to go on the offense pretty nicely with this advantage he's already built.
Como, a great option here against these two physical attackers. And, you know, it would take super effective damage from Breaking Swipe, but Breaking Swipe isn't the strongest attack, even with a Howl Boost under Gouging Fire's belt. And of course, always has the option to boost its defense with Iron Defense, and Body Press, of course, does not care about the attack drop.
Yeah, I think one other thing to consider here, too, is that James, like me, probably assuming Indeedee is that final Pokemon, mm-hmm. so he's got a lot of information now, can start planning the rest of the game because he has almost all the pieces.
Well, looks like a passive start so far protects from both the Iron Crown and from the Ogre Pawn. A Heat Crash actually connecting with Komo-o as Komo-o goes for a Body Press into the Spiky Shield. So the combination of recoil from the Spiky Shield and from the Heat Crash dealt a decent amount of damage to that Pokemon. We'll be able to heal up a little bit with the leftovers, but came pretty close to 50% there.
Yeah, and you mentioned, you know, Komo does like to face off against physical attackers, but, you know, taking all of that damage without getting any boosts up, quickly getting to the point where Iron Defense is probably mm-hmm. not super realistic in this match. So, you know, James, again, that's two very good turns from him, and he's now built up a pretty significant edge.
Yeah, James, still with his leads of Gouging Fire and Ogre Pawn, both with a Howl Boost and no options on Michael's side to remove them with things like an Intimidate, does have Whimsicott, but like you mentioned, showing Iron Crown means almost certainly the Indeedee, which will be coming in right now. Michael has had to choose this moment to go on the offensive. Psychic Terrain will be set up, the Psychic Surge spreading that across the field. Well, Iron Crown has a Calm Mind boost, and now going for even more multipliers. Psychic Terra type on the Iron Crown in Psychic Terrain with a Calm Mind boost. This is going to be a monstrous expanding force.
Yeah, we saw more defensive Iron Crown before. This one's going all offense, and Gouging Fire wants nothing to do with it.
Yeah, please, please, please leave me alone with the Burning Bulwark. Iron Crown's expanding force will not do any damage to the Gouging Fire, but will connect with the Ogre Pawn, which does have the special defense boost because of the Embody aspect, and because of that, even the plus one Iron Crown will not be able to pick up the KO. Instead, this plus one Ogre Pawn gets a KO right back.
That's a huge knockout now. That was a very, very important Pokemon to keep on the field if you're Michael. Really impressive mm-hmm. damage, but we kind of see again the consequence of how slowly he led with his lead Pokemon there. Never really gets Indeedee and Iron Crown out in the field together. They make it, you know, on the field for half a turn together, but with the way that played out, you know, no helping hand from Indeedee, which otherwise would have allowed a one-hit KO.
Yeah.
Kind of crazy to think about.
Yeah, through the Embody aspect boost, and now it's just the Komo-o that has taken so much damage from the Heat Crash and the Spiky Shield previously, trying to get something going for Michael. But of course, the Breaking Swipe does not care about the Follow Me. And even though Breaking Swipe is not the strongest attack with the Howl Boost and super effective damage, it still does decent damage to that Komo-o. Ogre Pond's Ivy Cudgel. Ogre Pond has been so angry this game, picks up a third KO. All three KOs for James have been through this Ogre Pawn as Komo-o just tries to go for a raw body press. Get that Pokemon off the field. Michael has no answer for it right now. And unfortunately, it is a little bit too late for this Komoo.
Seeming like it. I mean, Ogerpon has tears in those masks, but I think that might actually be from the other team doing just an outrageous amount of damage there. And I think that's going to be a huge problem for Michael throughout this set. You know, it just seems like this Ogerpon does everything for James in this matchup. So it's a pretty easy decision, I think, if nothing crazy happens in the match, just to commit the Terastalization there. Mm-hmm. I think often we see players kind of get punished for doing that. But here, I mean, like, realistically, what else you can do? You want the special defense boost. There's a good tight matchup with most of these Pokemon. Michael's going to have to find some answers here. I'm sure he has some, because the Wellspring and Ogerpon is simply too popular to be something you can't handle at all. But mm-hmm. that was just an incredible game won by James.
Absolutely. James was in control there, was ready for the Psyspam matchup, and did not allow Komoo to get rolling at all. Have to wonder if Michael just played a little bit too passively most of those turns. You know, of course, you went for the Calm Mind, but had to sacrifice his own Ogerpon to do so. That was a lot of damage, but not and then switching in the Komoo and not bringing in the Ndidi early meant that it was very difficult to get rolling with the Iron Crown. Of course, James also then revealing his third Pokemon, kind of maybe just an intimidation factor there, showing, yeah, I did bring Rillaboom, so you aren't safe to just click Expanding Force every time.
Yeah, I was ready, I just didn't need to be.
Yeah, exactly. Well, here it is, just a series of one-hit KOs from this Ogerpon on James's side, getting the Howl boost from the Gouging Fire, surviving even a plus one Terra Psychic, Psychic Terrain boosted Expanding Force. Ogerpon was a terror for Michael's team, just did not have enough damage. You know, there are a couple options though. You know, there is the chance of getting a Helping Hand to get that extra damage. There is a chance of maybe you could sneak in a second Calm Mind to get the extra damage. But again, the Rillaboom in the back means that it's never safe.
Yeah, and we're in the Incineroar-free side of the bracket. I think really seeing the impact of not having Intimidate, where the Ogerpon is kind of out of control. And this time we see more reasonable pairing here, where Michael's going to be able to get going a lot quicker should he choose to.
Yeah, I like this a lot. Michael also never got a chance to click Iron Defense with the Komoo, and this seems like a perfect opportunity in front of Gouging Fire and Ogerpon to start doing so. Michael bringing the Komoo and Hearthflame Ogerpon up against James's same leads, the Wellspring Mask Ogerpon and the Gouging Fire. You know, Michael went for some body presses earlier instead of in the game one instead of Iron Defenses and just took damage from Spiky Shield. Now he has an opportunity to start, you know, building up into that unstoppable tank.
Yeah, and the Howl mattered a lot the previous game, right? I think it's a lot harder just to Howl and not do anything with Gouging Fire here. You'd really like to get a Breaking Swipe out before there's an Iron Defense. So between that and now, you know, the option of using a Spiky Shield and not simply allowing your Ogerpon to be deleted, there's things Michael can do from here to really turn things around compared to how game one went.
Well, just like in game one, James will go ahead and Terastalize the Ogerpon, going for the Embody Aspect boost to the special defense. However, like you mentioned, Michael has other options here, hiding behind the Spiky Shield on his Ogerpon this time around, not taking any damage from that Breaking Swipe, and instead dealing it right back to the Gouging Fire. And like you mentioned, without the Howl boost already, that Breaking Swipe did not do a lot of damage to the Komoo, but James is not getting baited by this, going for as much damage into the Komoo as possible. And even still, with the Terastalization, that dealt a good amount of damage to Komoo. Again, more than 50% damage, but Michael at least did get one Iron Defense up this time. Yeah.
James is so good. Michael's probably still not too upset about this one here. And keep on, this again is the Follow Me Ogerpon, so at least could pull a single attack away, although we've seen how that is likely to end for Ogerpon in the previous game. Mm-hmm. But I think getting that extra damage for the Iron Defense is a big deal. It is going to be a difficult Pokemon for him to deal with, but if he's able to knock it out, the remaining Pokemon have a great matchup. And now we see the Howl. I really like how James is playing this one.
Yeah, James going for the Howl now on turn two instead of immediately. Has the faster Ogerpon, now does have the Howl boost and the Terastalization. We know that's a one-hit KO no matter what.
Oh no, little Ogerpon, not again.
Not again, but at least this time Komoo gets to land the body press, and that's a one-hit KO right back.
Komoo get revenge, and that could be a big deal. I think this Ogerpon, you know, is a big part of how James's game plan was supposed to work against your Iron Crown and Ndidi. So now James is going to need a little different solution than what we saw in game one.
Mm-hmm. Now, this Komuo has not Terastalized. Michael has not Terastalized at all. Bringing in the Indeedee this time around, while actually James will be bringing in the Landorus. Typically, you would want to see Fluttermane to be immediately threatening or at least forcing the Terastalization on the Komuo. So potentially showing that there is not a Fluttermane here, if you have to wonder if that's still the Rillaboom in the back.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be my assumption as well. So now we're kind of in an interesting situation where, you know, I think Indeedee, you know, gonna not love pulling attacks away, but potentially can do so, help out a little bit here, or maybe just scout things out as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this Komuo, you know, the Landorus will deal really good damage to the Komuo, has the ability to hit it from the special attack option. Indeedee can redirect every single attack that Landorus has, but over time will be able to be taken down by the Landorus, while Komuo really only able to fire back with a body press that Landorus will resist. So Michael is just going to try and play it a little bit slowly here to try and get some additional turns of leftovers recovery on the Komuo. A double protect here as the Heat Crash comes through onto Indeedee. And then James also going to be able to target down Michael's Pokemon with a Earth Power from the Landorus into the Komuo.
Yeah, so a pretty passive turn there, nothing really happening, although Michael kind of losing the option to protect either Pokemon now. Tactically could go for the double, but I can't imagine we'll see it. But does get to heal up a little bit, right? And you know, you kind of mentioned all the damage Landorus can do to Komuo. A little more difficult the opposite direction, you know. Mm-hmm. Only one Iron Defense, so the resisted body press, not super devastating there, and Indeedee gonna do its best to protect it.
Yeah, Indeedee just has to go for the follow me here. Takes a Heat Crash from Gouging Fire, even with the Howl, is survives by just a sliver of health, which will be immediately taken away by the Landorus with that Earth Power. So Indeedee goes down. It bought Komuo a turn. I hope it was worth it. Body press into Gouging Fire, still not enough damage to pick up the KO there. Komuo will be able to recover a little bit more health using its leftovers. And here comes the Iron Crown. Iron Crown with the booster speed we know is faster than the Gouging Fire, so we'll be able to outspeed and knock it out with an Expanding Force. But if James brought the Rillaboom to this match, the Expanding Force will be significantly weaker.
Yeah, no way to reset it now, right? I mean, that's the problem with the sequencing this direction. Michael kind of committing pretty hard here, but does get the two sweepers out together, both of them potentially threatening a lot of damage. So this is a difficult situation for James, right? You have to play carefully here. Could easily lose both Pokemon if he plays recklessly.
All right, and Michael targeting the Gouging Fire with the Expanding Force and body pressing into the Landorus, making a call that if the Landorus retreats for the Rillaboom, it will still take the body press, but it's going to be the Gouging Fire that retreats in favor of the Rillaboom. So Rillaboom will take this Expanding Force from the Iron Crown. That will be the Pokemon, the sole Pokemon on the field that takes damage from Expanding Force because the terrain has been removed. Michael will go ahead and Terastalize that Iron Crown as well, removing the weakness to the Earth Power and boosting the power of the Expanding Force. Again, we've gone from a Psychic Terrain boosted Expanding Force to a Grassy Terrain but Terra boosted Expanding Force on this turn, connecting with the Rillaboom, dealing a good amount of damage, over 50%, but again, only to that one Pokemon, and this Earth Power not quite enough to pick up the KO onto Komuo, and that one Body Press actually doing a significant amount, still not a two-hit KO, but more than enough for this now Psychic Terra to be able to pick up the KO with an Expanding Force into the Landorus.
Yeah.
I can't believe Komuo survived that.
I mean, yeah, that's huge. I think if Komuo goes down there, it's starting to look really bleak. Instead, it's very interesting. The other positive of Grassy Terrain, not only have you shut down the Expanding Force, but with Rillaboom having just entered the field, Fake Out is an option now. So we have a little interesting turn. You know, can either side kind of just predict things, take a little bit more than they've been given. No protects.
No protects. A Fake Out into the Iron Crown, which will be flinching, and Landorus now will be able to pick up the KO onto Komuo. So Michael went for an aggressive option, not going for the double protect play, perhaps afraid of James being able to get a free substitute with the Landorus if he had gone for that. But instead, that just means this Iron Crown is gonna have to try to find some way to make something happen, and I just don't see it with the Grassy Terrain up.
Yeah, Michael had to hit that read, right? Now there's three Pokemon left. Without Psychic Terrain, not able to hit two Pokemon at once, and that's just a lot of potential damage the other direction.
Well, Iron Crown going to go ahead and protect itself to get another turn of grassy terrain recovery and hopefully survive this onslaught coming through from the grassy glide and then the Landorus as well. There's the Earth Power, so stalled out a turn of grassy terrain, healed up a little bit from the fake out chip that happened in the previous turn. But Michael is going to need a lot more than that to win this game.
Yeah, I mean, it's getting a little scary too, right? If you ignore this Rillaboom too long, maybe you're going to need to hit in an extra time too, and there just aren't going to be many opportunities to attack in what remains of this game too.
All right, well, again, this Iron Crown is the fastest Pokemon on the field. And, you know, there is a world where Michael's able to stall out the grassy terrain and then be the fastest Pokemon, you know, even ignoring priority attacks.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that's what he has to do, right? I mean, and he's got to play this one out. You know, things are looking a little bleak, but the winner of this match will move on to the finals. You know, this is already game two. He's got to win this one to stay alive.
Here comes the Expanding Force targeting down the Landorus. That will deal enough damage to pick up the KO on that Pokemon. No grassy glide, though, which means that this Rillaboom is going to be able to fire back with a Wood Hammer in the grassy terrain. Meadow Plate boosted. That's enough for a KO. And James cleans up game two and advances to his second finals in a row.
Masterful performance there, right? Neither game ever in too much doubt. He just really played that match well, traded perfectly, and really impressive performance, right? A little different approach game one and game two, where Michael adapted well, I think at least made the game closer, but James's game plan was kind of bulletproof in that one.
Yeah, absolutely.